afternoon, brothers and sisters. Upon this gathering of your people, pour out your spirit, O Lord. Be near to us and speak to us, and we will proclaim your glory. Let us pray. God, our Creator, from nothing you made our world. You form us, love us, and give us all that we need. God, our Redeemer, you rescued us from sin. You have given us the new life and hope of healing it to the world. God, our Comforter, you are with us always. You comfort us, renew us, and guide us into your truth. Almighty God, for your gracious love for us, we praise for you in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Move from here to there, and it will move, and nothing will be impossible for you. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Joyful, joyful, we adore thee, God of
All right, everyone, we're doing a quick sound check to make sure that you all are hearing me. We are, wonderful. Thank you everyone for your patience. We're trying out some new things here this evening. Many of you probably didn't hear that scripture passage, so we are going to read again, right? Another chance for you to hear God's word to us through scripture. So this is Matthew's gospel in the 17th chapter. When they came to the crowd, a man came to him, knelt before him and said, "Lord, have mercy on my son, for he is an epileptic and he suffers terribly. He often falls into the fire and often falls into the water. And I brought him to your disciples, but they could not cure him." Jesus answered, "You faithless and perverse generation, how much longer must I be with you? How much longer must I put up with you? Bring him here to me." And Jesus rebuked the demon, and it came out of him, and the boy was cured instantly. Then the disciples came to Jesus privately and said, "Why could we not cast it out?" He said to them, "Because of your little faith. For truly I tell you, if you have faith the size of a mustard seed, you will say to this mountain, 'Move from here to there,' and it will move, and nothing will be impossible for you." This is the word of God for all of us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. First off, a special thanks tonight for our brand new tech team. You can't see them, but they're up here in these rafters making all these things work wonderful tonight. So the same amount of grace you extend to us every Presbytery meeting, we hope comes to us this one as we are venturing into new territory on how we are teching. A special thanks to the team from Indonesian Emmanuel Indonesian Presbyterian Church, one of our amazing fellowships scattered around our presbytery. Their team is here to lead us through worship. Also, the way we will be doing the meetings coming up, you will get a taste of different congregations on how they organize and come together around worship to be able to showcase for all of you how our body worships on Sunday morning. We're going to share those gifts with you on these next meetings coming up. This story starts off catching us in the middle of something that has already happened, much like many gospel stories that we read. What we don't get is what just happened previously or what is actually happening at the beginning of this. Jesus is coming down from this amazing moment of the transfiguration, right? He has a couple of disciples with him. They have had this encounter of God in ways they can't fully understand nor explain. And they come down back to the village to this encounter of a man who is desperately seeking some healing, desperate need of healing of his afflicted son. Mark's gospel lays this out a little bit more of kind of what's happening in the meantime while Jesus and the disciples are up in the mountain, and Matthew does not give us. And what we get from that is they've tried, right? They have gone to the disciples. This man who brought his son believes that this can actually happen. I've seen miracles happen. I have encountered Jesus and his disciples doing this. I'm going to now bring my son to this movement, right? I'm going to physically bring my son to the center of where I see these things happening that are changing lives and to see if this can also change the life of my son. So this man, this father, is showcasing this tremendous amount of faith. Something has changed around him. He has had an encounter with the living Jesus. Let me now bring my son to the ones like him in hopes that he is able to be cured and this illness that is afflicting him will be gone. So what we don't get from this story is what has happened a couple of chapters before this, right? That Jesus, on his sending out of these disciples for them to go out into different places and proclaim this beautiful image of the kingdom of God, he tells them a couple of things earlier in Matthew's gospel in chapter 10. He sends them out with this message, right? To proclaim the kingdom of heaven has come near. Heal the sick. Raise the dead, cleanse those who have leprosy, drive out demons. Freely you have received, freely give. He has already given them the power and the authority to do these amazing, beautiful, life-changing, miraculous things. He has told them, if you go out there carrying this message that you have already fallen in love with, that has made you follow me footstep by footstep wherever I go, now I am encouraging and giving you the power that you need to go out and do it yourselves. Go out without me, without my physical presence there. Go out, heal people, cast out demons, point them toward the wholeness that can be found in God's reign. So the disciples already have this charge. They already have the toolkits that they will need to cast out demons. But it doesn't work, right? Jesus is not there. He's gone somewhere. They don't know what's happening. They don't know how long he's going to be up on that mountainside. All they know is that they're supposed to do this work while Jesus is away from them, and they've been told they have the power to do it. Someone comes to them and says, cast out this demon from my son. I'm coming to you because I believe that it can happen. I want this demon gone from my son. Can you cast him out? So we don't know what the disciples tried, right? Probably a long list of things. Every trick that they've had in the book, they probably pulled out everything that they've been told how to do and every prayer to say, and for whatever reason, it is not working. They're not able to cast this demon out of this son. Back to Mark's version of this story. There's a line that the father says in Mark's version that we share around the church that says, I believe, help me with my unbelief. Because he says to Jesus, "What I tried it with your disciples, the ones who have the power and authority to do this, and for whatever reason, it didn't work. It didn't work. I would love to ask those disciples, what did you do? What did you say? How did that interaction go? What were you trying? Why do you think that it wasn't working? This man has come who obviously believes that it can, has the faith that your movement has the power to change lives, and for whatever reason, it didn't work. The question that I would ask those disciples was it believable? Was what you were doing, the way you were encountering this individual and his son, the prayers that you might have been saying, was it believable? And then, did you believe it? Did you believe that you actually had the power to do this? Did you fully believe the charge that Jesus gave you, sending you out into the countryside to do these things? Did you believe it? Could the man see the belief on your face? Could he hear it in the words that you were saying? Did he see it in your body position as you were kneeling down to pray? Were you believable? And did you believe that you could do it? Some of you around the presbytery know some of my faith journey. I went to a tiny liberal arts undergrad in the middle of Kansas. That was my first experience with what we call the evangelical church world. And I had a lot of friends who would try to invite me to come to things like FCA, the Fellowship of Christian Athletes, or InterVarsity. And I would entertain them, and I'd come to their events, and I would sit down and listen to the guest speaker that they had coming to share. And I didn't have a huge issue with the theology, right? It's still centered around Jesus and what Jesus can do for your life. My issue of why I chose not to come back and to be involved in that was less about the theology and more about, I didn't believe you believed it. I didn't feel it from you. If you are really on fire for the presence of Jesus, I felt no radiant heat coming off of you. I didn't believe that you believed it. There is a line that the generation above me and some folks of my generation still use that I hear from my mother regularly. I probably heard it this morning. Is game recognize game, real recognize real. That I can sense it from you a mile away. That you are actually about what you say that you are about. That I believe what you actually believe. I believe that it is fully within you. Everything you are doing or saying says, yes, this person is absolutely about whatever it is they're doing. I fully believe them. Game recognize game, real recognize real. A better way to wrap that up is the word authenticity. right? Is it real? Is it believable? Authenticity can't be measured, but you know it when you feel it. You can sense it, hear it, smell it, feel it, taste it a mile away. Is this thing real? Is this what the people are saying that it is actually going to be about? Is it real? Is it authentic? For our churches around this presbytery who say they are serious about a long list of things, following in the footsteps of Jesus, proclaiming the gospel to every edge of the corner of their neighborhood and their community and their context. If they're serious about doing things like anti-racism or building new community, they say they're serious about these things. We need to feel it. We need to know that you are absolutely about what you say that you are. So when new people come to engage with your community of faith, whether it be through the front doors of your church or on a platform like this, are they feeling the very real presence of Jesus? If you're on fire, can they feel the radiant heat coming off of you? Is it authentic? Do the people in your pews sharing their encounters with the risen Lord, is it believable to someone who might have only had a brief encounter with the divine? When they speak to folks in our congregations, are they believing them? Do they recognize that in them is something powerful? In them is something so miraculous and beautiful and wonderful that it has the power to make mountains move. Can they see that? Can they hear that? Can they smell that? Can they taste that? Can they know that from a mile away and not have to sit through a service and hope that it happens? Can they feel it right away? How are you engaging with the folks in your community, the folks in your digital or in-person community, in a way that is real and authentic to the love that you have for the very real presence of Jesus? As I said, authenticity is very hard to measure, but you know it when you see it. As many of you know, I say that I am a hip hop aficionado, but it's really more like a snob. And I'm now, how old am I? I'm 38 years old, and I'm now categorized as an old head when it comes to the American musical art form of hip hop. So a quick lesson on how hip hop was put together now since 1979, that DJs would take pieces of music from an old disco song or from an old R&B song or even an old rock and roll song, and they like the drums off of this song, they like the vocals sped up off of this song, and they like the bridge from this song. Let me take all of those and mix them together and create something completely brand new that feels like a whole new song, even though it is what we call sampled off of different pieces of music. That is the backbone of how the music part of hip hop is put together. And we call that DJing, we call it also producing. So in the 70s, it's record players. As it grows into the 90s, they're still using records, but they're beginning to use a machine to make the sound work. And this machine is called the MPC. Now, for those of you who have been to the African American History Museum, you might have seen what's on your screen right now. This is an actual MPC. What you would do is all those little like keypads that you see on there, that's 16 blocks of keypads. You would program different drums from this record, different vocals from this record, different breaks and introductions and strings and whatever. And you would then play the drums on that thing, tapping them to create the whole new song. So this MPC that you are seeing right now is the actual MPC that was used by a producer named Jay Dilla, whose real name is James Yancey. And for old heads like me, aficionados and snobs, Jay Dilla is the grandmaster, is the one who has done this like no other producer has ever done. And Jay Dilla would use this computerized digital machine to load up all these different sounds and then play them to make the new music. The MPC had a very special feature that made it easy for productions. So if you just need one measure of music, you would play that up, and then you could, what is called quantizing, you could fit that in so that all the downbeats lined up at the same spot, and then you would just repeat that for the whole rest of the song. What made J. Dilla's music so special is that he chose to turn that feature off and to actually play from his hands when the drums would come in and when the vocals would start and when the strings would come in or when the break would happen. And he would do that for the entire song. So when you put it up to something that was computerized and fully automated and done, it doesn't fully match up perfectly, right? Because it's real. It's authentic. It is actually done by someone's hand throughout the whole song. And this doesn't come out until afterwards. He died at age 32 from a very rare blood disease in 2006. And it comes out later that this is why his music was so special, because he was turning off a feature that made it easy. And now the music felt that much more real because he was playing it the whole way around. I can talk a lot about this, but it would be a travesty for you not to hear it. So what we're going to do is play for you a snippet of what J. Dilla's music would actually sound like as he incorporated all of these different sounds. And it goes a little bit something like this.
I never knew a la, 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 a la like this. Gotta be something for me to write this. Queen, I ain't seen you in a minute. Wrote this letter and finally decided to send it. Signed, sealed, delivered for us to grow together.
For those of you looking for a starting point on the musical art form of hip hop, that album right there by the artist named Common called Like Water for Chocolate is a very good starting point for you to enter into this beautiful journey that some of us have been on for years. J. Dilla made beautiful, beautiful, real music. Artists that I have looked up to my entire life, every single one of them has worked with J. Dilla to make some of the most beautiful music that genre has ever seen. His way of doing it has touched the furthest corners that is still being used today in the way artists make their music. It's believable. It feels very real. This feels like real music and not a computer program, not something that is supposed to be perfect and fitting in and lined up and just right and all of these things match. It is supposed to feel very real because it's music. It's beautiful. It can't be perfect. I hope that we approach our work as the church from that lens, not trying to be perfect, not trying to match it up exactly the way that we think it is supposed to be, but to let it be real. Let us play it as we go, instead of setting it once and hitting repeat and saying we've figured it out, now let's fine tune it so that it can work and keep going on down the line. Let's play it as we go along, because that makes it real and that makes it authentic. In order for this to happen, in order for 2,000 years ago, for that man who was desperately trying to heal his son to happen, in order for all of this to happen, it takes a tremendous amount of faith. But a better word for that is trust. Those disciples needed to have a tremendous amount of trust that what Jesus told to them months before was still true, even though he wasn't there. That you still have the power to cast out demons, to heal the sick, to feed people. You had that power, even though Jesus physically wasn't there with them. They needed to lean in into a tremendous amount of trust. And so did this man, coming and bringing his son who is falling down in fires to cook the food at his home, is spilling over pots of hot water. He had this amount of trust that I am coming to something that I can't fully understand, but I know it to be real, and I know that it has the power to heal my son. Friends, let us lean into that amount of trust. That even though Jesus physically isn't here with us right now, we are still in that same lineage of discipleship that has the power to cast out demons and to heal people. If we believe that it does. He finishes this conversation with the disciples about saying, were you praying hard enough? Did you believe that it was going to work? What did you do that was happening? You needed to have faith that was the size of a mustard seed in order for it to do something like move mountains. This next season in our presbytery, we're going to talk a lot about growing our congregations. Not in numbers, not in metrics, not people chimed in to a Zoom call, but what are going to be the impacts that we are going to have in our community, all for the work that Jesus has charged us and equipped us to go out and do in this world. We need to believe that we actually can do it. Because if we do, we will be on fire. If we do, the radiant heat beaming off of us will be impossible not to feel by those we come in contact with. Let our faith, even though it might be feel as small as the side of a mustard seed, let us trust that that is enough to do something like move mountains, to do something that feels like it is impossible to do, to heal a sick boy, to cast out demons, to extend the ministry of God's reign here on earth, inviting more and more people to share in that beautiful, real, and lovable story. I'll leave you with this. My oldest son, who just turned 4 2 days ago, has a rule in our house that he's allowed to actually watch a movie from start to finish, and it's typically been the Disney movie called Cars, while his younger brother's taking a nap on the weekends. So he has expanded his movie repertoire now, and now he watches a movie called Kung Fu Panda. And not to spoil it, oh, I am going to spoil it for you all. Sorry, it's been out since 2008. Kung Fu Panda is the story about these great Kung Fu masters who are trying to harness the goodness of Kung Fu, and they need a new dragon master, and it accidentally, but yet on purpose, as part of the destiny, is this out of shape, out of breath, large panda who's supposed to be this dragon master. And his adoptive father runs a noodle shop. And the special thing about this noodle shop is that there is a secret ingredient that he's eventually going to share with his son when he's going to take over the noodle shop. But he now becomes a dragon master, and he's now working with the Fabulous Five as they battle all different kinds of evils around the world in Kung Fu. So at the end of the movie, when they're asking about how Po, this character, has the ability to do this without the training, without the expertise, he's still out of shape. How is it that he is able to do all of these things? It's because he believes that he can. And he goes back to talk to his father and says, obviously, I'm not going to work in the noodle business. What is it that I need to know the secret ingredient? And the father says, there is no secret ingredient. That the people believe that there is something special happening here, and then that special thing gets to happen. So we don't have a secret ingredient. What we have is the beautiful powerful story of the gospel that can change lives, can cast out demons, can heal the sick, can feed the poor, can be the breath of presence to the depressed. It has those powers to do that. We need to believe that it can. Because this world is waiting to encounter something real and authentic that can change their lives. So friends around our churches, go out into your communities, go out into your context, go out into your neighborhoods, and share a faith that is real, authentic, and believable. Amen.
My sisters and brothers in Jesus Christ, because of God's great love for us, we believe that the one who is rich in mercy has made us alive in Christ Jesus, even when we thought we were dead. For by grace we have been saved through faith. We have been raised with Christ and seated in the heavenly realms. And this is God's gift, not earned by works, so that none of us might boast, for we are Christ's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good things. In him we have been brought near, and he himself is our peace. His purpose was to create one new humanity. So we are no longer foreigners and strangers, but fellow citizens with God's people, members of one household built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus as the chief cornerstone. In him, we are all joined together, a holy temple, a dwelling place in which God lives indeed, a church that can, that must, that will grow. Let us pray. God of grace, you care for a whole earth. Even now you are reconciling all things to yourself. We thank you for the ancient grace given in Christ Jesus before the ages began. We humbly reach out to you with praises and bring before you our concern for our community and world. At this time, we do our best to let go of our fears, our waves of anger, and our cynicism, and to trust in your steadfast love. As we trust in you, we pray for those who deal with pain, whether it is physical, emotional, spiritual, or any other type of pain. May you bring peace and healing to those that are hurting. Comfort those that are grieving and experiencing the loss of loved one, relationships, jobs, safety, and security. Restore to them the joy of your salvation. We pray to all of the churches around the world, for the church around the National Capital Presbytery, especially Calvary Presbyterian Church, Capitol Hill Presbyterian Church, Catoctin Presbyterian Church, Chestersbrook Taiwanese Presbyterian Church, Chevy Chase Presbyterian Church, Christ Presbyterian Church, Christ the King Presbyterian Church, Christian Community Presbyterian Church. O God, give your church fresh courage and bold vision in this changeful time. Rekindle in us the sincere faith of Christ and make us willing and faithful servants. O God, we lament how refugees from Afghanistan, South and Central America, and Haiti are being treated in this nation. Your beloved children are not being seen or treated with human dignity, and we cry with them on empty promises of hope given. Give us the nation the tools and empathy to enact your commandment to love the stranger. Again, we say to you, God and gracious God, we trust in your unfailing love. Give us confidence and joy in all that we do, for we offer our lives and our prayers to you in the name of Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray. Holy God, we call upon your names. Your wisdom come, your will be done in all the spaces in which you dwell. Give us day sustains and preserves, remind us of our limits as we give grace to the limits of others. Separate us from the temptation of empire, but deliver us into community. For you are the dwelling place within us, the empowerment around us, and the celebration among us now and forever. Amen.
May you trust that the story, the powerful story of who Jesus was, is, and will be, is strong enough to change lives. And may you trust that your retelling of that story is also strong enough to change the lives around you. Wherever that you go and whatever it is that you do, know that you are always blessed. Amen. As we get ready to transition into our business meeting, we will keep this open for you all. For those of you who have been around with us since open space, please go get something to drink, take a break, stretch your legs a little bit. We'll keep this on. There'll be some videos playing in the background. And before we jump into that, we will get a chance for you all to share the wonderful blessing of peace that has been given to us directly from Jesus with each other. So may the peace of Christ be with you all.
With you.
Peace be with you.
Peace be with you all.
Peace.
Peace, be with you peace all. Friends.
Peace be with you.
Peace be with everyone.
Peace of Christ be with everyone.
Peace to all.
Peace be with you.
Peace be with you.
Also with you.
Yeah. Peace be with you.
And also with you.
Also with you.
Peace be with you.
Also with you.
Peace with you.
Peace be with you.
Peace be with you.
Peace be with you.
Peace be with you.
And mm-hmm. with all of you.
Also with you.
Peace be with you.
Peace, y'all.
Christ be with you all.
Peace be with you.
Amen.